Let us try to understand today the dye dilution method or indicator dilution method for the measurement of body fluid compartments, measurement of the ECF volume and measurement of the cardiac output. It's commonly referred to as Stewart-Hamilton dye dilution technique or indicator dilution technique. Let's first understand how this technique is used for measurement of the ECF volume. Let's understand the principle behind it, the very basic fundamental principle. We will take an initial volume of that indicator or the dye. A known initial volume has been taken. Now, what is the basis? What is the basis for this method? Let's put it simply. There are these two volumes. Let's assume A and B. And now we are going to put the initial known volume of the indicator or the dye one by one in these two compartments. If same volume of the dye or indicator is placed in these two compartments, what you can observe is in the A, because volume of the A is larger, the dispersion of this dye will be to a greater extent. And that means the dye, the indicator, will be diluted to a greater extent in this compartment, in this volume A. And therefore, once it is uniformly distributed, we will collect the sample and we will see the concentration of that dye. Obviously, if same volume of the dye or indicator was placed in A and B, concentration of that dye in the A would be less because it got diluted to a greater extent in the compartment A. So when we collect the sample and measure the concentration of that dye or indicator, lesser the concentration means more, greater is the volume of that compartment. That's the basis for dye dilution method or indicator dilution method for the measurement of ECF volume, plasma volume, or generally body fluid compartments. Now, let's actually see the indicators that are used. Indicators which are used for the measurement of ECF volume, they are generally non-metabolizable saccharides. Best one is said to be the inulin. Inulin is a fructopolysaccharide. Now, these are non-metabolizable saccharides, whether it's inulin or mannitol or sucrose. They should not be entering the cell, or rather they should not be metabolized by the cell. They should stay in the compartment. The indicator which we inject into a certain compartment, let's say in this case we are talking about the ECF. So the indicator, after it is injected into the ECF, what are the criteria? It should uniformly disperse throughout the compartment. It should not leave the compartment. It should not enter the cell if we are measuring the ECF volume. It should not leave the compartment, it should not enter the cell, it should be uniformly dispersed. And these, therefore, are the indicators which are used. Best one is the inulin. So we will inject a known initial volume of this indicator or the dye into the ECF. It will be uniformly dispersed into the ECF, and after that we will collect the sample. And then the formula is V, that is volume of the compartment is equal to I upon C. I, the initial volume of the dye or indicator injected, and C is concentration of the dye after it got dispersed into the compartment. We collected the sample and measured the concentration of the dye, and as we have already discussed that if the volume of that compartment is greater, there would be a greater dispersion of that dye, it would be diluted to a greater extent, and that means its concentration would be less after its dispersal. So that's how we measure the ECF volume. Now, if after the initial injection of the dye, some amount of the dye left the compartment, then A, that is amount of the dye that leaves the compartment, whether it is entering the cell or it's leaving the compartment that you're measuring, it has to be deducted from the numerator. So the formula becomes V is equal to I minus A upon C. I, the initial volume of the dye injected, A, the amount of the dye or indicator that left the compartment, it has to be done minus from the numerator, and C is of course concentration of the indicator after it got dispersed uniformly in that compartment. So this is how we measure the ECF volume. There was a question that there is a dye or indicator, it is injected into the blood vessels, it was for the measurement of ECF volume, and it was found that after injecting that indicator, it leaves the circulation via capillaries. How will it affect the measurement of ECF volume? Mind you, this dye or indicator was injected into the circulation, and then it was found that some amount of the dye leaves the circulation via capillaries. How will it affect the measurement of ECF volume? Our first instinct would be that we will consider it to be A, the amount of dye that left the compartment, left the capillaries. No, it would not affect the measurement of ECF volume, because if that indicator leaves the capillaries, it will enter the interstitial fluid. And if it is in the interstitial fluid, that means it is very much in the ECF. Remember, we were measuring the ECF volume. So always look at such questions carefully. If the indicator leaves the compartment, no, it hasn't. That's not mentioned in the question. It hasn't left the compartment you are measuring. We are measuring ECF volume. We injected into the capillaries. From the capillaries, it went out, but it went into the interstitial fluid, which is very much the part of ECF. It remained in the compartment. So always look at such questions very, very carefully as to what is happening to the dye, whether it is really leaving the compartment. So that's ECF volume measurement by indicator dilution method. Now let's come to the cardiac output measurement by the same method, or rather the principle would be the same. Cardiac output measurement by the dye dilution method. Let's first understand how this method is performed for the measurement of cardiac output. A known initial volume of the dye is injected into a vein. So initial volume is known to us, and then it's injected into the vein. It goes to the heart, and then left ventricle will pump this dye into the artery. The moment it starts coming to the arterial side, immediately the samples will be collected. Now, remember, in the case of ECF volume, we were collecting just one sample and measuring the concentration of that dye after it got dispersed evenly into the compartment. Whereas here, for the measurement of cardiac output, we injected the dye into the vein, a known initial volume was injected, it went to the heart, and then heart pumps it, the left ventricle pumps it into the artery. The moment it starts coming to the arterial side, we start collecting the samples one after the other, let's say every 2 seconds or every 5 seconds, we start collecting the samples. Because with each stroke volume, the dye is going to appear into the artery. And then we will start collecting the samples from the artery. Let's say we collect the 10 samples from the artery. And then we will find out the mean concentration. We have taken numerous samples from the artery. We measure the dye concentrations in those samples. And then we take a mean concentration from all those 10 samples. That's how the method is performed. Now, what is the basis for this? Let's put it simply. Let's assume that one person with a stroke volume of 100 ml and another person with a stroke volume of 70 ml. If you inject same initial volume in both these persons, what do you expect? In the person who has got a stroke volume of 100 ml, the dilution of the dye will be much greater, much faster. So the basis of this method for the measurement of cardiac output is that stroke volume dilutes the dye. It is a stroke volume which dilutes the dye as it comes to the arterial side. So that's the basis. Now imagine someone whose stroke volume is 100 ml. The dilution of that dye will be to a greater extent. And therefore, if you collect the 10 samples and take the mean concentration of the dye would be less. I mean, imagine stroke volume was 100 ml. So a greater stroke volume means greater dilution of the dye. With each stroke, it is coming to the arterial side in a diluted manner. And therefore, we take samples and find out the mean concentration of the dye, it would be less. So less the mean concentration of the dye means higher is the stroke volume, and that means greater is the cardiac output. In the case of 70 ml, the stroke volume, the dilution of the dye would not be that great as compared to the stroke volume of 100 ml. So it's all based on just one basic fact, and that is stroke volume is going to dilute the dye when it comes to the arterial side. So greater the stroke volume, greater would be the dilution of the dye as it comes to the arterial side. And then we use the formula. Now remember what was the formula for measurement of ECF volume? It was V is equal to I upon C, where I was the initial volume and C was the concentration of the dye. Over here, it's almost the same. F, that is flow or cardiac output, is equal to I, that is initial volume of the dye injected. So numerator remains the same, upon C. Now this is mean concentration of the dye. So C is mean concentration of the dye, because we collected 10 samples maybe and just found out the mean concentration, into T. So we have added one more factor over here. T is time in seconds at which the dye appeared for the first time in the artery. The dye appeared for the first time in the arterial compartment or in the artery from where we were collecting the sample. So that's T. Now, this itself gives you the idea. T is the circulation time, and it would be in seconds, maybe 15 seconds or 22 seconds. Now, if there is a hyperdynamic circulation, higher cardiac output would mean hyperdynamic circulation. And that means when you inject the dye in a vein, it will come to the arterial side rapidly because of that hyperdynamic circulation. It means the T would be less because dye appeared rapidly on the arterial side for the first time. And that means if the T is less, if it is coming to the artery in less time, that means it's a hyperdynamic circulation. That means cardiac output is more. So lesser the denominator, greater would be the cardiac output. So this itself would give you some hint, some idea about whether the cardiac output is higher or normal, just a vague idea. So that's a formula. Well, one more thing to be added in this, into 60, because we need the cardiac output in liters per minute. And what is the denominator over here right now? It's seconds. So to convert it into cardiac output per minute, we multiply it by 60. Denominator was in seconds. Now we have converted into per minute, and that's how we get the cardiac output by dye dilution method. Let's also see some of the fallacies in this method. Let's take the situation we discussed with the ECF volume measurement. There is a new dye that was brought into the market, and it was found that this dye leaves the circulation rapidly out of the capillaries, just like the previous dye that we discussed with the ECF volume measurement. This dye also leaves the circulation rapidly. It leaves via capillaries out of the circulation. How will it affect the measurement of cardiac output? Well, the answer is no effect. Now, let me just clarify this point. When we talk of something leaving the circulation via capillaries, we mean systemic circulation and not the pulmonary circulation. Let that part be very clear. Now, if this dye leaves the circulation via capillaries, systemic capillaries, it's good. It would not affect the measurement of cardiac output, because it's very simple. We injected the dye in a vein. It went to the heart, and heart pumps it into the artery. And from the artery, we started collecting the samples. And after we collected the samples from the artery, then it has gone to the capillaries, and then it leaves the capillaries. It would not affect your cardiac output measurement because we've already collected the samples. So if the dye going out via capillaries for measurement of cardiac output, it would not matter at all. We are talking, I reiterate this fact that we have not taken into consideration the pulmonary capillaries, because in this circuit there would be pulmonary capillaries that would be there, but we are not taking that into account. Capillaries would mean systemic capillaries. The substances leak out of systemic capillaries generally. So that assumption has been made. So if the dye goes out of capillaries, systemic capillaries, it would not matter. It would not affect the measurement of cardiac output, as we have already collected the samples. So in fact, this would be a better dye if it goes out of systemic capillaries, because we only collect the samples for the first time when it comes. We have injected the dye in a vein, it goes to the heart, it comes to the artery, and we collect the samples when it came for the first time. We do not consider the recirculated dye. I mean, some of the dye might just recirculate and go back to the vein, go back to the heart, again come back to the artery. So it can again elevate the concentrations falsely. So we are not considering those samples. We just collect the samples when the dye comes for the first time in the artery. We don't take into account the recirculated dye. So if the dye leaks out of the capillaries and we are measuring ECF volume or cardiac output, both would not be affected by the dye that goes out of the circulation. ECF volume, because the dye remains in the ECF as we discussed, and over here it leaks out of the capillaries, fine. Now let's also see some more fallacies in the measurement of cardiac output. This method is unreliable in certain conditions, for instance regurgitation conditions, regurgitant valves. In the case of regurgitant valves, the mixing of the dye with the stroke volume would be erroneous. It would not be normal. Because of the regurgitant blood, the dye mixing with the stroke volume and then coming to the arterial side where we collect the samples, it would be erroneous. It would not be normal, and therefore the method would not be reliable in that in those conditions. Or septal defects. So in all such conditions, the dye dilution method would be unreliable. In fact, there was one such question which was repeatedly asked. Imagine there is a ventricular septal defect. What would be the error in the estimation of cardiac output? Let's write down the formula over here. F is equal to I upon C into T into 60. Yes, there is a ventricular septal defect. What would be the error in the measurement of cardiac output? Now, in ventricular septal defect, as you are aware, the left ventricle has a much higher pressure compared to the right ventricle. And therefore, when the dye was injected, it went into the heart. Then from the left ventricle, some of the dye may go back into the right ventricle through that defect, ventricular septal defect. This is just a diagrammatic representation. And that means the left ventricle ejecting out the stroke volume and that dye with the stroke volume, and it is coming to the arterial side, less and less amount of dye would come to the arterial side. That means the mean concentration of that dye would be less, because less and less dye is coming to the arterial side from where we are collecting the sample. Since less dye came with each stroke volume, the mean concentration would be erroneously low, and that means cardiac output would be erroneously high. So this error would occur, and therefore in such defects, the dye dilution method is not reliable. So this in summary is the indicator dilution or dye dilution method for the measurement of body fluid volumes and cardiac output.